In this video, we're going to be taking a look at some different types of graphical displays and different things to keep in mind when you are in a position to create a graphical display. So if we want to talk about principles of quality graphical displays of data, here's what we want to think about. Thing one, a quality graphical data display should represent the data. Accurately. Okay, we want to represent the data and we want to do that in a way that is accurate. Whatever story it is that the data are trying to tell, our graphical display should help to enhance that. It shouldn't skew the data, it shouldn't bias the data, it should accurately represent the trends that are present in the data set itself. Also, they should induce the viewer to think about the substance of the graphic. In other words, they should avoid distractions. I don't know how many of you may have had the opportunity to watch PowerPoints that people are presenting that have data displays in them. But you can do all sorts of fun things with your pie chart, for example. You can have it kind of whoosh onto the screen and it can make bells and whistles when it comes on and pieces of it can jump out and do stuff. All of that's nice and it might keep people interested in your presentation if you're doing a PowerPoint presentation. But all of that stuff distracts people from looking at the actual data display that you're taking time to create and that is trying to convey the substance of your message. So you really want people focused on just the data display itself. You don't need any of those extra bells and whistles. That's just going to distract people from the graphic. And then the last thing really to think about is to avoid distorting the message of the data and you want to obey something called the area principle. Okay, obey the area principle. And I'll give you a couple of examples of this whole area principle thing. I'm going to make two histograms here, side by side. The first one is going to have okay. So here's an example of a data display that wouldn't be obeying the area principle. One of the interesting tricks of the human psyche is that we tend to interpret the area of a segment of a graph as being proportional to the amount of data that is contained within that segment. So a lot of people would look at this graph here, and for example, if they were just looking at, let's say, these last two pieces, a lot of people would assume that this piece actually has more data in it than this piece does because it appears to have greater area. And the problem with that is we all know if this is a histogram, it's the height of the bar that's important. The height is what determines the number of pieces of data, and this bar actually contains more data than this one. So basically, the idea with the area principle is that the only difference between the visual presentation of these categories should be the thing that actually matters. In other words, if the width has nothing to do with the amount of data that's in there, then the width of all of these should be the same. They should be evenly spaced. So we should have, you know, we had this one right about here. We had this other one that was shorter, and it should be of the same width. This next one that's taller should be of equal width to the other two. Then this one that's a little bit shorter than that should be of equal width with those three, then this one, you know, equal width here, and then this tall one, equal width. These are both displaying the same relationship between the pieces of data, but I think you'll agree that they look very, very differently. So this one's a big no-no because it disobeys the area principle. This one is good. Similarly, you can do something like that with a pie chart. We'll talk about those in just a minute, but let's say we have this pie chart here, and maybe it, I don't know, does something like this. This is a good version of a pie chart. The only difference between these segments is the proportion of data that are falling into them. The largest segment of the pie has the most data in it. The smallest segment of the pie has the smallest data, or smallest amount of data. Now, what you'll frequently see people do with pie charts, this is an option in a lot of software programs, is they'll turn them on their side, and then you might have this, for example. These are trying to convey the same information, but the relationship between the area of these pieces is a lot harder to view here because we've tipped the pie chart on its side and we've changed the perspective. We have skewed the results by changing the perspective of the pie. So again, this one disobeys the area principle. The width of the pie has no bearing on, you know, the relationship between the different variables that were being studied. So we would not use this version, we would want to use this version instead. Even though it's a little bit less snazzy looking, maybe it's a little more clear cut, a little bit more boring, but it accurately represents the data and it doesn't distort the message. Okay, so those are some things to think of about quality graphical data displays. They represent the data accurately, they induce the viewer to think about the substance of the graphic so they avoid distractions, and they don't distort the data by disobeying the area principle. Okay. Now, some of the graphs that we're going to talk about in this section, I'm sure you're already familiar with. Bar graphs are the first ones. Okay, bar graphs can be used for quantitative or qualitative data. They can be vertical or horizontal. So you can have the bars, you know, going vertically like this, or you can have your bars going horizontally like this. Oops, sorry. This one is not a bar graph, because in a bar graph, the bars don't touch. Right? If they touch, then you're looking at a histogram. So the bars don't touch. Bars are uniformly spaced. Okay, uniformly spaced and have equal widths. Because of the area principle. So we don't want bars that touch. We want to have space in between them. Those spaces should be uniform. They should be the same amount. And the widths of the bars should also be the same. The length or height of the bars indicates counts or percentages of the variable. So it can measure frequency or it can measure percentage, just like a histogram. But histograms can only be used for quantitative data, and bar graphs can also be used for qualitative data. So that's the idea with the bar graphs. Now there is a special kind of bar graph called a Pareto chart that your book also talks about. So a Pareto chart is a bar graph where the heights of the bars represent frequencies, rather than percentages. They're actually the frequencies, the counts. And then bars are vertical, and ordered from tallest to shortest. So Pareto charts, the reason that you would use these, because they're ordered from tallest to shortest, you're always going to get a graph that has, you know, the tallest bar is here. Maybe something like this. And what these are really useful for is emphasizing categories in order of importance. So if you wanted to, say, make a poster to show patients in a doctor's office what the leading contributing factors to a heart attack are, this would be a really great display because the tallest things or the things that would most raise their risk of heart attack would be emphasized because they would be placed first. So it's from increasing to decreasing amount. So that's really the power of a Pareto chart. It's just a special kind of bar graph that you use when you want to emphasize categories in the order of their importance. The next type of graph that is discussed is the circle graph or the pie chart. They can go by either name. And again, I'm confident that you've probably all seen these before. Circle graph or pie chart. Circle graphs or pie charts are used for qualitative data only. Okay, they are not used for quantitative data. Wedges of the circle represent usually percentages of the data that share a common characteristic. Okay, so you'll see these a lot in, budget work, for example. If you have an operating budget for an organization, let's say it's maybe a charitable organization, and you want to show people who are going to donate to your organization what all of their money gets used for, you might have a big chunk over here that goes for, you know, overhead, and you would have the percentage labeled on here, whatever numeric percentage that is. And that would be the portion of your budget that goes to, you know, building space and staffing and office supplies and all that kind of stuff. Then maybe you have something that's like, well, maybe you split out salary and benefits from overhead. So maybe over here you have salary and benefits for your employees as a percentage, and down here you have the amount that actually goes to your programs as a percentage. Okay, so it's used for qualitative data. You'll notice that the variable here is the type of expense, so overhead, salary, benefits, programs. Okay, and the proportions of the circle represent the percentage of the data that actually falls into each of those categories. Really, the power of a circle graph or a pie chart is it can emphasize how a whole or a total of something is divided into different segments. Okay, so that's what a circle graph or a pie chart is really for. And then the last main type of data display that's discussed in this section is the time series graph. And in a time series graph, we graph measurements of the same variable for the same individual over regular intervals of time. Okay, we graph measurements of the same variable for the same individual over regular intervals of time. To give you an example of this, let's say you start a new jogging program. And on day one of your jogging program, you record how far you're able to jog in, let's say, 30 minutes. And let's say you go, I don't know, you're really out of shape. So let's say you go a half a mile. Okay, so there's day one. Then day two, maybe you're really sore. And so you actually do a little worse than you did on day one. Okay, and then on day three of your new program, maybe you're up quite a bit. And then day four, maybe you backslide a little. Day five, maybe we're up here. Day six, maybe we're up here. And when you connect these dots, what a time series graph is really useful for is in the short term, because of the volatility in a data set like this, you know, you start up, you go down, you go up, you go down. It's hard to see if any progress is being made, but over time you can see that there is a general trend to this data. You do appear to be improving on your jogging program. After day six, you're quite a bit above where you started on day one. Okay. But notice that we're measuring the same variable, the distance covered in 30 minutes. Okay, same variable for the same individual. We've only included one person on this graph. We haven't included multiple individuals. And then regular intervals of time. I'm taking my measurement in this case daily. Okay, but I could take the measurement weekly, monthly, what have you. But the intervals of time need to be regular for a time series graph. Stock market data is also displayed the same way. And again, it's to identify general trends over time. Okay, so in summary, bar graphs can be used for quantitative or qualitative data. Pareto charts are what you would use if you wanted to emphasize the frequency of occurrence of your variable in decreasing order. Circle graphs show how a total is dispersed into several categories. And time series graphs look at how data change over time.